Hi, everybody. My name is Brendan Gibbs. I'm Vice President of Juniper's Automated WAN Solutions business. I'm joined today by Ray Mota, CEO and Principal Analyst of ACG Research. Ray, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you for the invite. Appreciate it. The weather's perfect over here in California.
But it's called Sunnyvale for a reason.
That's a good point. That's a good point.
Ray, I always love talking to you because you have such a unique perspective on the service provider industry overall. You talk to everybody. One thing I just would love to learn from you is, what are you seeing in terms of service provider uptake of automation? What are they doing?
Yeah, no, it's a good question, and I think it's important to understand the rationale with it, right? I would say over the last 2 years, it's become a high priority. Right now, they're looking for simplification and automation across different parts, not just in network automation, but business automation and upending the process. And a lot of that is driven because their customers, for the first time, are accelerating the digital transformation. It used to be that I used to talk to a lot of these enterprises about digital transformation, and it was more slideware, right? But now they're accelerating because business continuity and service profitability. So it's good to see that service providers are reacting to that piece because they have a risk at that pace. They could miss the inflection points for that area. So for the first time, we're seeing not only them implement it, but seeing positive results. We recently did a survey where we saw over 72% actually saw an increase in customer satisfaction of the service that they're delivering because of network automation. The time to deliver new services is over 52%. And then the OpEx, was the biggest concern, is actually on average between 32 to 40% increase when you start looking at automation, more than just task management. Automation, when it gets to related to operational efficiency, operational agility, and business agility.
Wow, that's an amazing set of statistics. I mean, clearly it's having a big impact. Yeah. I wonder, you mentioned in the last 2 years it's accelerated. Do you think any of this is driven by COVID, as in the SPs found themselves just kind of stuck at home all of a sudden?
Yeah, no, I think that's a big driver for it because, you know, with this new hybrid work at home strategy, right, they realize, like, I can't get to the office like I could. And it wasn't just even things like segment routing, simplifying networks, things like different parts of automation. But I think the biggest thing that a lot of them realize is there were a few, Brendan, that actually thought they had automation, but they have silos of automation. And that became difficult to manage remotely. So a lot of them realized that they needed to look at cross-domain and change their mindset to start thinking about the service that I deliver, what are the services and how do I automate from an end-to-end, kind of like security, right? Security is as strong as your weakest link. So when you look at a security domain, you look from an end-to-end type aspects of it. So automation should be not just physical assets, it should also be some of the virtual assets together, especially as you start moving to this hybrid cloud, SaaS, physical environment. And I think when you start removing those silos of automation, that's where you're seeing the positive impact there.
Wow, that's amazing insight. You also mentioned enterprises. Yeah. Are enterprise customers of SPs, do you think, are they driving the kind of the use case for automation, or are there other use cases they're really responding to?
You know, there's some service provider use cases itself, right? There's the part of the disaggregation that's going on in mobile. Mm-hmm. So like OpenRAN, VRAN is becoming a high priority, and those are great from a cost CapEx, but if you don't bring automation to address the operational efficiencies in there and the risk exposure, when you do things like network slicing that allows you to scale and offer new revenue, you're gonna create an operational nightmare. So service providers need to understand as they go to deliver these services, private 5G is another use case that's high, right? Which is more vertical enterprise. Network automation needs to be a thought process from day one. I use the analogy back, I can probably mention, if you look at a server at AT&T versus a server at Google, right? To manage one server at AT&T, just management, it was about $600 annually. It doesn't sound like much, right? But when you look at the number of servers they had, that adds up to a pretty number. Mm-hmm. That same server at Google would be 1 cent.
1 cent versus 600.
Because everything from day one is automation, simplification, visibility, and control.
Wow, that's a huge disparity. I mean, that just is mind-blowing.
Yeah, it needs to be solved, right? Yeah, they need to solve it, right?
So, how do service providers think about this?
Well, they look to see what's worked, right? And I think if you look at some of what the web scalers have done, right, they've done a good job to say you need to start thinking of automation from day one. You need to be able to have a hybrid environment across. And it's good for service providers because they have a lot of legacy, but now because there's these transitions and investments in 5G, they realize that consumer 5G, the business case isn't quite there yet, right? Just they can't justify the CapEx spending. So as they look for ways for, let's say, Open RAN to work on the CapEx reduction, they really need to look to offset the investment by looking at things like private 5G, but look at what web scalers have done in the past with the plug and play and end-to-end mindset. So they can literally learn a lot. And a lot of them now are looking at, when you look at what you call Industry 4.0, mm-hmm. where you look at certain verticals, that's something that there's a part in there that web scalers play well, which is a telco cloud there, mm-hmm. you know, capacity and compute. And the service providers primarily focus on the connectivity layer, right, which mm-hmm. is 5G or wireline. But there's other layers on top of there, edge services layer, and then you have applications layer, right? And web scalers have been good at creating this ecosystem environment. So there's a lot of lessons, and a lot of these service providers need to figure out, how do I become web-lite type customer there?
Yeah, you know, I remember thinking a few years ago that service providers and public cloud operators, the hyperscalers, were like oil and water.
Yeah.
And especially as you say, telco cloud, a lot of operators, you know, it seems to be, without being too dramatic, they saw the public hyperscalers as competitors.
Right.
Of late, we've seen a number of partnerships.
Yeah, quite a bit. Yeah.
So now I'm wondering, you know, given what you're saying, that massive disparity, and also a little bit more closeness between them, is there a role for public cloud in an SP automation world?
Yeah, there is, but they need to be careful. There's a mix, right? You're going to see a mix. So I think from a service provider point of view, you need to make sure, do I have the skill sets, number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, who wants to own the customer, right? And this is an important part that they need to be careful with, right? So you're seeing AWS, Google, Azure go in there and on the edge services to say, we can get you cloud ready by offering that piece, right? So there's a revenue share opportunity that they can do in that area. But service providers need to be realistic also to say, when I do revenue share, who's gonna be responsible for the customer?
Sure.
So if the service provider has the skill sets, the challenge I think has been is that these service providers need to find some solutions to say, could I implement network automation myself to do DIY? And if they have the skill set or find the right partner to help them with that, then they got a solution to say, in this particular service I can partner, this one I wanna do DIY. So finding a vendor that could help them with that network automation intent becomes an important factor.
Well, do you think that service providers are more open to vendors, whether it be a public cloud operator or a vendor like a router vendor or a switch vendor, optical vendor, offering some sort of package solution? Or are they all still kind of thinking, I need to, you know, build my own automation suite from scratch?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, I think when you look at that part of it, it's a mix. It's a mix. I've seen some work successful, and I've seen some nightmares, right? Because what a lot of the service providers realize is that when they build their own product, someone's got to support it, mm-hmm. someone's got to maintain it, someone's got to bring the staff with the right skill sets and be able to keep that staff happy to do that. So they, in a way, they have to become a vendor. Like, who do they call when a problem happens? They look at themselves, right? Like, whose neck do they choke?
Right.
They choke themselves, right? So I think a lot of service providers that have gone in that route going, time out, I don't want to choke myself, right? I need to find somebody else
right.
from that. I always talk about where I was a naive CTO when Linux first came out, right? And it was one of those things where I'm like, wow, I could save my company millions of dollars. I don't need to go with this particular operating system. But then I realized, like, what happens when something breaks when I do DIY? It would have been my neck to choke. So then I found a vendor's neck to choke, but they also educated me on more pieces where I wasn't an expert, like the optical layer mm-hmm. and other pieces for that area. So I say it's mixed because there is a handful that do have the right skill sets, but I think from a longer or bigger TAM perspective, it's better to partner and not become a vendor. Do what you do good, right? And focus on that and find partners that you trust that could deliver and be there for you in case there's some support issues associated with that.
I think that makes a ton of sense. And just taking together a few things that you've said already, it almost seems like there's different layers to think about from a DIY perspective, do it yourself. There's the telco cloud layer, and maybe that doesn't need to be done yourself. Yeah. And as you were just saying, maybe the software layer on top of that doesn't need to be customized. It's more the services, the unique aspects that would be customized for an SP, right?
Yeah, that's correct. I mean, I think what a lot of service providers, the ones that are being successful, are realizing that the service that they're considering deliver needs to be agnostic of the infrastructure, right? And if that's correct, right, then that's where you bring in automation from an end-to-end point of view. And any service provider that could get to that level is going to be able to deliver services much quicker. But when you have to first say, well, this is the architecture I've got, these are the only services I could deliver, then all of a sudden your time frame to deliver these services becomes a problem.
Actually, I want to key in on that exact point in terms of time frame. Time to service, quality of deployment, et cetera, is, you know, I think, top of mind for everybody.
Yeah.
I wonder, I'm very interested in your thought. I wonder if there's an opportunity for service providers to have a mind towards that time to deployment, time to service reality, and start consuming things as a service from public cloud, like SaaS, for example.
Yeah, some of it depends on certain factors based on the CapEx they have, right? So, and then the time frame, the miss opportunity, because customer acquisition cost, the longer you wait to deliver the service, the longer it goes up, customer acquisition cost. And that's a number one priority for board level members in service provider. But then the lifetime value of the customer is reduced if you miss it. So what ends up happening, let's say it's a managed service contract, if you're late to market, you either have to buy out the contract, right? So that increases the cost, right? Or you have to wait till that contract expires. And then your delivery of time. So it's really important to have a situation where you could plug and play and get to market quicker, especially at the pace that your enterprise customer, because they'll move without you at this point. They move without you.
It makes sense. Well, what are some of the key factors for SPs? For example, you mentioned a few key attributes in terms of improving time to market, time to service delivery, reducing costs, maybe reducing complexity. The answer may be all of the above, but is there like a primacy there? Like, how would SPs look at this? Like, they want to optimize around one of those factors, the others are nice to have.
Yeah, no, I think there's two discussions. Anytime I go into a board meeting for these service providers, if I don't have one of the two, it's not going to be a good meeting. The first one is, how do you help me save money? Right? What solutions or group of solutions could you help me to optimize my profitability? That's the first. So Open RAN or VRAN would be a discussion associated with that. Then the other part is, how do you make me money? How do you increase my TAM, right? And that's where I identify things like private wireless or private 5G to say, these are some low-hanging fruits. You have the infrastructure, right? Now you need to expand it into an area and develop a go-to-market. So those are the two areas. How do you either make me new money or increase my TAM, or how do you reduce my OpEx? And network automation applies to both of those there.
Yeah, and I'm wondering also then, how does, say, the quality of experience play into the latter case?
Yeah.
You know, how do you make money? Because I'm just thinking about, how do SPs use automation not just to reduce their costs, but also as a competitive differentiator, rather?
Yeah.
How do you get quicker time to market? How do you deliver better quality experience to your customers? How do you basically use that as a competitive weapon?
Yeah, no, I think quality experience is something, me being a former CTO, that I was really naive about. So we recently did a survey, and it was a number two priority. Customer experience, when it got to prioritization, customer acquisition costs was number one. The other one is, how do we increase and maintain? Because they spend so much money to acquire the customer, right? A big priority is, how do I maintain that customer? And the reason they lose it is because of customer experience, right? And there's enough options out there with systems integrators and others to say, if you're not gonna give me customer experience, I'll either find somebody else, because things could run in the cloud, right? Or I'll find an integrator and I try to do it myself there. So that's been the number two. It was an eye awakening for myself.
Wow.
But it's an important factor,
Yeah, I actually wouldn't have dreamed it was this.
Yeah, no, same here.
It's compelling.
Yeah.
What comes next then? I mean, you've already said that one of the key learnings has been, you need kind of an end-to-end approach, break down the silos. I think that was what COVID taught. What happens next?
Yeah, I think when you start looking, I think from a future outlook perspective, there's a few things, right? So if you look to say, okay, now I'm looking at things from a service point of view and an end-to-end point of view, and if you look at things like machine learning, AI, I mean, me and you are old enough to understand those protocols and algorithms have been around for 20 to 30 years in some cases. But the problem is you needed a PhD in-house to figure out how to implement it, mm-hmm. right? And get it to work and see the value, and that used to take years. Now, these things run in the cloud, right? And because they run in the cloud, right? You could look at it from a cross-domain perspective, and you could work on what you call the input parameters. What do I need? You send it to the cloud, does the complexity for you, and you're able to do that more efficiently. So I think that's the next part of saying, this is where the future is going, moving a lot of that intelligence to the cloud, and then I can look at things from across domain and use it when I need it and stuff like that. So a lot of innovation going on in that space there.
Man, I love that. I just have one last question then.
Sure.
Just keying off what you were just saying, it almost seems like, and this is a question then, that it seems like what you're positing is using automation to take highly complex topics, but you know, make them easily consumable by the masses, so to speak. Correct. Like, as you say, AI and ML and other sort of yeah. complex algorithms, you shouldn't need a PhD on your staff right. to use automation. So it almost speaks more to automation as an easy button rather than say automation as say, software developer, DevOps, or PhD level complexity.
Correct.
Is that true?
Yeah, that is correct. I mean, I think, you know, you're seeing areas of automation and AI machine learning. I mean, like I said, I'm old enough to remember people used to talk about it, but it was just too complex. I mean, we're seeing in some cases 13-year-olds develop iPhone app where they're able to put in the input parameters, send it to the cloud, and the cloud does all the hard work, whether it's Z analysis, whatever type of algorithm they're using in there. They don't care and they don't want to know, just like that service provider is developing the service and the underlying infrastructure to say, plug whatever service you want. We become a platform for innovation, and because we have automation that includes network automation, security, as well for all the provisioning aspect, we handle all the complexity for you. You focus on how do you deliver the service, how to develop your go-to-market, how to price it, those type of things there.
That's super compelling. This has been a great discussion, Ray. I mean, my takeaways are automation is paramount and it's mandatory.
Yes.
Simplicity is going to be the name of the game, as well as end-to-end without any silos. Incorporating security, incorporating that kind of holistic focus, but becoming a springboard for future innovations, as you're saying.
No, it's exciting times. Yeah,
absolutely.
Well, thank you for the invite there.
Thank you, Ray. This has been great. Thanks to everyone for listening as well.